Edward J. Robin Blanger here on the 26th of April, 2012. And I just going to do a little bit of dictation here with regards to Richard Marx. Richard Marx works for the Alberta government for the Solicitor General's Department under Freedom of Information. And I wrote him a demand subject to 337 of the Criminal Code. Some month or so back, and he has refused, subject to the sections of 337 of the Criminal Code, to recognize my authority under the provisions of 802 of the Criminal Code, giving me the power of full answer and defense. Subject to that interpretation, and of course everybody in Her Majesty's system is assumed innocent until they are proven guilty, and as such is of the complete capacity to demand all property, records, papers, documents, anything whatsoever, as is described in 337 of the Criminal Code, so as to enable that man or woman accused to defend themselves fully. And that's what full defense and answer refers to. Richard Marx seems to be of the opinion that 337 of the Criminal Code does not apply to him as a civil agent of the Solicitor General's Department affecting freedom of information requests. I informed Richard that this was specifically not a request, and the reason I was making the demand, and Richard seems to feel, with the advice of some dubious government lawyers working for the province of Alberta, has seen fit not to respect and honor 176 of the Criminal Code. Just one moment, please. So the purpose then of making this particular record here is so that his superior, Michael Michalsky, of the Solicitor General's Department of Corrections, FOIP, he deals with FOIP. I spoke with him this morning and I made him aware that denial of Richard Marx could also be seen as nuisance, 180 of the Criminal Code. Denying their duty and making somebody feel uncomfortable by refusing them to provide them with property necessary for their full defense, thereby bringing the administration of justice into disrepute and extreme suspicion as to why a system that tells you you get the right of full defense, and when you demand the property necessary for your defense, other bureaucrats within the system feel that they get to ignore you and intimidate you. So I felt quite intimidated by the attitude of Richard Marx. He made me feel very uncomfortable and process was obstructing the official functions of my ministry. I am a Christian minister and he is a civil agent. And he was acting under the pretense of some civil code, FOIP, to obstruct my ministry and intimidate me and prevent me from doing what I have a right to do, and that is namely defend myself. Well, that obstruction and that intimidation leads to nuisance. And all three of those sections of the Criminal Code come into play on top of 337 of a public servant failing to produce property. In light of the fact that they're doing all these things and they were put in place in a trust, a position of trust, to deal with these matters, it would appear that failing to do those matters upon presentation of the law in clarity would indicate there's a willingness and a desire to be in a breach of trust. So this is getting quite serious for Richard Marx, and I'm hoping you, Michael Michalsky, are taking attention to this and that you will attempt to recognize that my duty in contact with Bob Marr, who is a provincial court crown prosecutor who I spoke with this morning, is to make you aware that I have the authority to ask for that documentation. I have the authority to ask for an oath of allegiance from a Crown prosecutor or a judge or a clerk if I feel they may have taken an invalid oath and are in violation of Her Majesty's duty to defend the laws of God. This is by a Coronation Oath Act of 1688, which is an enactment of the laws of Parliament, and also of this country, Canada, must respect and honor that law, because Her Majesty's duty as defender of the faith is written into law in the Royal Style and Titles Act that you can find on Justice Canada's website. That is correct. Her style and title is Defender of the Faith. Well, clearly we can see why the preamble to the Charter states, whereas Canada is founded on the principles that recognize the supremacy of God and the rule of law. It was put there by a Christian monarch that was, of course, herself sworn to defend the laws of God, and anything else in the preamble would largely speak to a fraud. Looks good, we got the Bible, we got a Christian monarch, but let's add the God's law for money and start trading people on the stock exchange. Well, nonetheless, that's exactly what's taken place. Men and women were registered as financial entities and listed as corporate members of the country corporation known as Canada that does trade on the stock exchange and is domiciled in Washington, D.C. These are not opinions or fluff or some kind of made-up story. These are facts. These are world-class facts and speak to the very basis of the operations of the so-called countries that are really debtors to the creditor who is at the top. The old story, follow the money, really comes home and really comes to light when you try to figure out what's going on, how we could have had a Christian monarchy put in place with the Bible as the rule of law, stating in Deuteronomy 4:2, 12 through 32, don't add to my law, don't take away from my law, this I command you. Then having a Christian monarch get right on top and swear an oath, she'll defend the laws of God with all of her power. Well, when God said, don't add to my law, don't take away from my law, this I command you, that's another one of the laws that the queen must defend. If you go read carefully, you'll find out that she never did swear a law that she would defend the laws of men. She did assign an enactment, put her signature to it, that she would defend the laws of God, she would defend the church and the clergy. So anything in derogation to the laws of God or the church and the clergy instituted by the Parliament of men or by the Parliament of legislatures or municipalities is all intimidating, make this clear, intimidating men and women to violate the commands of God. Because everybody knows that lives in a municipality or a province or a country that if you don't do what the government says, go register your children, they're going to come and fine you for $50,000. If you don't get a fishing license and you're going out there to feed, they're going to take your truck, your anchor, your boat, your fishing lines, your fishing boots, and whatever else isn't attached in light of defending the laws of God. Well, how does that make any sense? That doesn't make any sense at all. What it's called is legitimized extortion. It's fraud. But if nobody complains about the fraud, it's not a fraud. The reason that I'm requesting these records from the Solicitor General's Department is prior to July of 2010, the Solicitor General's Department were in charge of the health records at Fort Saskatchewan and at the Edmonton Remand. After that date, the Minister of Health took over in charge of all medical records and chose, quite unintelligently, to archive all the records of any man or woman that had stayed in those facilities that were previously recorded under the Solicitor General's Department. That means that if any man or woman came back into those facilities that previously had a health record there, there would be no health record of that man or woman there because they are all archived now. And that means if there was any life-threatening information with regards to medical treatment that was needed or should not be provided on those files, the nursing staff and the men and women there that are working for the Minister of Health to ensure that men and women imprisoned were taken care of properly and treated medically properly, well, they didn't have access to those files. And if any of those prisoners claimed they had medical problems, they were just ignored. And they would not retrieve the archive files so that that prisoner who was in a suffering medical state could prove and exonerate himself that he did need medication and indeed he did need medical treatment. As a result of doing this archiving of the files, the Solicitor General's department and the Minister of Health's department, the new authority coming in, Both had a responsibility to ensure all parties were going to be aware that the archiving of the files put all the men and women that may be coming back into those facilities in jeopardy. Because if you don't have the medical files and there are life-threatening situations with an inmate with regards to whether he needs his medication or he's not getting it, that's absolutely essential to have on hand immediate access. They provided evidence that they did not only have immediate access to my files when I was in a life-threatening situation, but they also ignored their duty to go and bring the files out of archives to ensure I wasn't brought into harm's way and my medical condition was not exacerbated and made worse. They didn't do that. They failed in their duty. I got very sick, suffered, bled internally, was refused my medication, refused my diet, refused my water, all upon their attitude that they could make me suffer and they had the legitimate authority to do it. That's where the problem comes in. When the Minister of Health interrupts my ability to get those records by demand, the Minister of Health is aiding and abetting criminal activity. The Minister of Health is really engaged in a conspiracy to aid and abet that criminal activity and prevent me from defending myself. Well, that is not sanctioned by law. And all he has to do is look up the Duplessis case where Ron Corelli sued Mr. Duplessis back in 1947, and in 1959, 12 years later, the Supreme Court of Canada said, you exceeded your public authority, Mr. Duplessis. You're privately liable. You've got to pay for the whole case out of your pocket, plus you have to pay Mr. Ron Corelli $50,000. So the situation there was that public officials, such as Mr. Duplessis, the most powerful public official in Canada, had no authority in law, statute, code, or regulation to do what he did. As it turns out, there was no authority, statute, code, or regulation to deny me my medication and medical treatment, proper food and water in the facility. And the fact that I suffered horribly, had an internal bleed, and still suffer today because of a shrunken down and scarred pylorus, which is the valve that leaves from my stomach, it is down to about this big, when it should be about that big in a normal stomach. That was caused by them deliberately failing to give me my medication with lots of witnesses on the record. And that's why I'm demanding these records. They must be brought forward to give evidence that I was subjected to cruel and unusual punishment in not only the Edmonton Remand Center, but the Fort Saskatchewan Center. And I'm wishing to bring forth the records so I can find out the name of the men and women that were responsible, namely the nurses. I believe one is Amenders. I wasn't very sure about her name. She was a Chinese nurse. And she was the one that seemed to take the greatest pleasure in making me suffer. Eventually, I had to phone the ombudsman for medical. And I wasn't even made aware that one existed. As a matter of fact, they didn't even have the phone numbers listed up in the prison. Somebody there, one of the staff, had to go look to find it, and it took them quite a while. But they did. They came up with an ombudsman to the governor general's office lieutenant governor's office with regards to health matters. Soon as I told them I was being denied medication, I'd called the RCMP to complain, and they wouldn't do anything. I'd called so many places, health services, CanPro to complain, and nothing was being done. And then I was on the point where I'd have to be taken to the hospital pretty soon. Within 2 hours, my medication magically appeared. This after 2 months of almost daily demanding that I get my medication. Going without water and food and medication for over 7 days is life-threatening to a man with my historical medical record. They, with a chagrin and smile on their face and full intent to make me suffer, perpetrated that with an intent. That's mens rea, and I can prove that if you release those records. And I'm demanding it under 337 of the Criminal Code, which I have the authority to do because I have authority. I'm a living man. If you try to say the government of Canada or the government of province has authority, well, how can something that's dead in law, no heartbeat, no flesh, no blood, no veins, have authority over a living man? When you can explain that, you've probably learned a lot about the fraud that I'm trying to expose, because that's exactly what's taking place to everybody in Canada. Some dead corporate entity in law that doesn't even have the courage to put up a living man to say, we have the authority to intimidate you to violate the commands of God. There isn't anybody there that's coming up to say that. So then the question is, how does that take place? How does a corporation all of a sudden own you and tell you what to do? How does a corporation trade you on the stock exchange without your consent, bond you as a child, and put you into slavery? That's the question, and that's why I'm demanding this information, which is indeed property and is indeed anything, as described in 337 of the Criminal Code, which was put there to enforce the law against you from offending me, the private man, under Christ as defended by the Queen. I am not a corporate entity with an all capital letter backwards name. There is no law that allows you to do that to my name. Please understand, that is fraud. I don't consent to it. I'm not part of the corporation known as Canada. I'm not a citizen. I'm not a taxpayer. I'm a man under Christ, following Christ's law that the Queen most dutifully defends. If you attempt to intimidate me, you're attempting to intimidate Her Majesty. That's 176 of the Criminal Code, 180 of the Criminal Code, 423 of the Criminal Code, Section 46 of the Criminal Code. And if you attempt to say anything negative to the Bible and my ability to defend it, that's 296 of the Criminal Code. I'm a man like a Sikh that won't take my turban off. I won't take my faith off. And I'm demanding that you produce the authority that you have to do that, or intimidate me, or make me feel uncomfortable, or use my name for a financial purpose without my consent in an altered form that is clearly done in fraud. There's no law that allows you to capitalize my name, Richard Marks. There's no law that allows you to register a capital version of my name in a commercial instrument, Michael Michalsky. And Bob Marr, being a provincial prosecutor, waiting for this information that I need from you, subject to his own law, 802 of the Criminal Code, knows I have the authority. He knows I get to demand this. So when I go to court, appearing amicus curiae on May 11th, I'm going to be taking the fact that you refused to give me the information. You interfered in my ability to exercise full defense. Your names will be listed on the record. I will be contacting risk management. I will be contacting professional standards. I am not doing this to be malicious towards you. I'm doing this to defend myself, protect myself. And so folks like you that feel they get to intimidate people that violate the commands of God and their faith that the Queen most dutifully defends, can't do that. So that you learn that that's wrong. Bad boy. Your grandmother would shake her finger at you. So I hope that you consider that I've done all this, officially performing the functions of my calling. Again, with no intent to intimidate you, I am the one that's intimidated. I am the one that's obstructed from practicing my faith and beliefs unimpeded. I am the one that's being nuisanced by being made to feel very comfortable by public officials who have a pseudo, false, bogus oath of allegiance to a Christian monarch, are in effect running a fraud and treason towards Her Majesty's ability to defend the laws of God with all of her power. So I thank you so much for your time, and I hope you will recognize this was not a frivolous effort. This was very sincere, very logical, very spiritually inclined, and motivated by my extreme passion for my belief that Christ gave His life and His blood to free us from men and women of vampirish nature, such as the government of Alberta and all those men and women that feel they can take their power and clump it and thump it over men and women's heads that wish to practice their faith in Christ. You can't do it. We won't let you do it. And you're criminal for even suggesting that you could. I thank you so much for your time, and may God have blessing upon you and forgive you for your sins. Bye for now.